Look up into a clear night sky, and you'll see thousands of different stars dotting your view. While they all may look like pinpricks of light from our viewpoint, to some of you keen observers, you'll notice that some of them look slightly different from others. Some are bright. Some are barely visible. Some are white. And others are reddish or even blue. How can that be? Why are stars so different from each other? I'm Alex McColgan and you're watching Astrum, and together we will learn all about the various types of stars and find out what makes them all so interesting. Let's start off by having a recap of where stars come from. Although space is a vacuum, it's not a true vacuum in that there are still tens to millions of particles per cubic centimeter, like hydrogen or oxygen. These particles make up what we call the interstellar medium. The interstellar medium is surprisingly massive, making up 15% of the mass of our galaxy, the Milky Way. This is a lot, considering that the mass of the interstellar medium is compared to the hundreds of billions of stars found in the Milky Way. The interstellar medium exists throughout space, but it's not evenly distributed. The densest parts are called nebula, which can either be colorful regions of ionized gas, or cold regions called molecular clouds. Generally, these clouds are supported by their own internal pressure, pushing out against the inward pull of gravity. But every so often, these clouds collapse because of external sources. When the internal pressure of the cloud is overcome, this causes the particles within them to clump together under their own gravity. As the clump begins to build up, its density and thus gravity increases, causing more nearby particles to get drawn in. These particles begin spiraling inwards and around the center of mass until they eventually impact the central object. With the combination of the force of these impacts and the increase in pressure inside the object, it begins to warm up and spin. This is what we call a protostar, or if you want to imagine it this way, a star in the baby stage of its development. Every star has these humble beginnings, but what happens next decides the fate of the protostar. The molecular cloud feeding into the protostar will eventually run out of material, or the protostar will be ejected away early in its protostar phase. If this happens before the protostar reaches 0.08 solar masses, or 0.08 times the mass of our Sun, the protostar will become a brown dwarf, or a failed star. Should the molecular cloud feed enough material into the protostar that its mass amounts to over 0.08 solar masses, the protostar will eventually become a main sequence star, or, in other words, it will reach the adulthood phase of being a star. Why this 0.08 solar mass cutoff? It's because stars with a mass above 0.08 solar masses are big enough for nuclear fusion to take place in the star's core, where the pressure there will convert hydrogen to helium as a power source. At this mass, as long as there is hydrogen to convert, it is self-sustaining, needing no external source to keep it hot. Brown dwarfs don't reach the mass and pressure at the core needed for nuclear fusion to take place, so they will eventually cool off. Their cool and dim nature means that brown dwarfs are pretty hard to see. There are certainly none in our sky visible to the naked eye. Their dim nature means it's hard to put an estimate on how many there are. There could be a lot more in existence than we currently know about. Zooming in on Hubble's picture of the Orion Nebula shows quite a few brown dwarfs visible against the backdrop of the nebula they formed in. The ones we know about are really interesting, but brown dwarfs could have a whole video to themselves, so maybe I'll save it for another time. So, our protostar has reached 0.08 solar masses. What happens next determines the type of main sequence star it will become. When the molecular cloud eventually stops feeding material into the protostar begins to cool and contract. This increases the pressure at the core until the pressure is so great that nuclear fusion occurs, the reactions of which create an internal pressure which counteracts any further contracting. Or, in other words, the forces within the core of the star are in equilibrium. At that point, the protostar hits the main sequence. But what type of star will it become? Let's have a look at the spectral class chart. I want to draw your attention to this band by here. This band indicates that these stars are on the main sequence. As you can see, stars generally belong within this curve. The lowest mass stars are found to the bottom right of the curve, where the molecular cloud ran out of material early on in the star's protostar phase. These stars are small and cool, in a category of stars called red dwarfs. As we go up the curve, it indicates that more mass was fed into the protostar as it developed. And the more mass there is, the hotter the star. As the temperature of the star increases, the spectral class shifts, moving from red to orange to yellow to white to blue. Not only does the spectral class change, but the brightness of the star also increases. But if this is the case, why is this band so thick? Surely it should be a much narrower band if the mass is always equal to the temperature and luminosity. Well, that would probably be the case if all stars were the same age. But throughout a star's adult phase, it is still changing slightly. As a star's hydrogen gets diluted by all the helium it has now generated, it is more difficult for the hydrogen to fuse together. The equilibrium within the star shifts slightly to a smaller, denser, hotter core to maintain the fusion of hydrogen. This means over time, the luminosity of the star increases slightly. A good example of this is our Sun, as it used to be only 70% of the brightness it is now. Going back to the chart, a star that may start here may shift to over here over its lifetime. But, as is often the case with anything, there are some outliers and exceptions to the rule. On this diagram, you'll notice this band here. This is known as the instability strip and is full of variable stars. A variable star is a star whose brightness and diameter increases and decreases in regular intervals, giving them a pulsating appearance. Some take only hours to pulsate. Some take weeks. A breathtaking example of a variable star seen by the Hubble Space Telescope is RS Puppis. It varies in brightness by a factor of 5 once every 40 or so days. Because this star is surrounded by a beautiful dust structure, we can see the variable nature of this star through a light echo. Light travels extremely fast, but it still takes a long time to get across astronomical distances. This means we can see the precession of light traveling away from the star, with some rings being dark as the star was dimmer, and some rings being brighter as the star brightened. Hubble imaged RS Puppis over a 5-week period, and you can actually see this light echo pulsing. They exist along this strip here because at this mass, the internal structure of the star is more prone to instability due to the ionization of helium in the star's convective zone. Again, perhaps a topic for another video as it gets pretty complicated. Another variable to main sequence stars is what material was actually fed into them during the protostar phase. The majority of the interstellar medium is hydrogen, but there are other atoms out there like helium, oxygen, and even metals like iron and gold. If a star has an abundance of metals, which in the case of stellar structure is anything above an atomic number of 2, it will be redder on the spectrum, and metal poor stars will be bluer. So, as you can see, there are lots of factors for main sequence stars to be different from each other. These are their mass, or how much material was fed into the star during its protostar phase, their age, have they only just become main sequence stars, or have they had time to increase in brightness, and their composition, are they rich or poor in metal? Well, I hope you learned something today about the main sequence of stars, and hope you'll stick around for the conclusion to this series with what happens to stars once they run out of hydrogen fuel. In that, we'll look at black holes, neutron stars, giants, and supergiants. But can't wait for next time. Brilliant has an amazing astronomy course on what makes stars different, which really delves into the details and maths of star development. And the best thing is, thanks to their iOS and Android app, you can take this course and many others on the go with you, thanks to their offline content, so you aren't bound by an internet connection. If you want to support Astrum and get unlimited access to all of Brilliant's in-depth math and science courses, you can head over to brilliant.org/Astrum to get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, I'm sure you'll like my others on space too, so subscribe so you don't miss out. A big thank you to those who support my channel, especially my patrons and members. If you would like to support too, find the link here or under the video. All the best, and see you next time.